30 years, a whole generation, has slithered into history since police terrorists murdered MOVE family members by dropping a bomb on their suburban Philadelphia home. Not content with that, the apparatus of repression imprisoned most of the survivors as if it were they who had done wrong. It still holds some of them. All MOVE did to draw the iron fist so brutally was to stand in opposition to the ruling class's juggernaut of modern techno power. MOVE did not close its eyes to exploitation and oppression. MOVE did not cower in fear in the face of injustice. MOVE did not seek some bargain with the system. MOVE stood, and the empire struck back. 30 years on, imperial capitalism continues its atrocities from the very dungeons right here at home in which MOVE members and too many of their class brethren and sisters still languish, to drone massacres without charge or trial halfway around the world. Rapacious corporate interests trail imperial legions to inflict war and poverty and oppression in the name of plunder justified as profit. And they still drive over people who stand against them as they drove over MOVE. But had MOVE not been a rock in the torrent of political and economic effluent imperial capital spews upon the world, it would be worse. Had MOVE not stood against the tide, the politics of death and destruction would be yet another step ahead of us. But MOVE did stand. That standing still raises consciousness that slows the ruling class's roll. MOVE's sacrifice was not in vain. So let us remember the atrocity committed against MOVE. Let us remember that the road to revolution is rough and rutted. And let us remember standing up.
These commentaries are recorded by Noel Hanrahan of Prison Radio.
Oh yeah, Black Sun in the Hizzle, oh for shizzle dizzle. We got an excellent show here today, but first I want to say the views and opinion and that of the arena does not reflect that of Black Sun, its staff, its affiliates or associates. And the views of Black Sun, let me say it again, the views of Black Sun does not reflect that of the arena. We are a council, okay? All right. This week, we're going to do Mr. Gray some justice because, you know, last week we were shooting at the hip, you know, Dougie, Gideon, Tiffany. Yes, y'all were just shooting at the hip, just throwing conversations around. I got the A-team here today, as Gideon would say, the A-team. But first, before I get to the A-team, I want to introduce the lovely guest to my right. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Hello, I'm Ava. Happy to be here today.
That's good to see you, Ava.
Thank you.
All right. And to her right?
Hi, I'm Tracy. Happy to be a part of it.
Tracy, all right, Tracy. To her right, we got, introduce yourself, you got an extravagance.
Y'all know me, Vince Cheeks, AKA Ghetto Messiah, entertainer and activist. Yeah. Glad to be here, glad to be back. I had a little vacation, but I'm back at home.
You got a new title. The Arena Stabilizer.
The
Arena Stabilizer, like yes. To his right.
What's up, man? It's Yang. It's good to be back every week. National spokesman of the People's New Black Panther Party. Chairman of Atlanta, Georgia. Man, it's good to be back, man. You know, I enjoy doing the thing.
It's good to have you back, Yang.
And look, you know, I hate to come back that my Malcolm X is messed up. They got me on the Bob Barker today.
I know, I'm going to fix that. I'm going to fix that immediately.
No, man, it's good to be. So you miss me? Did you miss me, man?
I miss you, man.
Okay.
I miss
okay.
you.
Well, I'm back.
The arena misses you. Back. And I miss the order.
Okay.
You know?
You missed that A-team.
I missed
that A-team.
Yeah. Yes, the A-team. And this man right here comes with all the information. You know, and from research is so important, especially for Black people, because, you know, we just start just making up stuff. Because it sounds good.
Wow.
It just sounds good at all. Yeah, they just be just freestyling.
Right.
Gideon. Just be freestyling. Tiffany.
Yeah.
Dougie. All right,
let's get to it. I got a couple of announcements before we get into this heavy, heavy topic. August 22nd, 2015, we got a health and wellness reggae music festival, 12 noon to 9 p.m. at the Wren's Nest, 1050 Ralph David Abernathy Boulevard, Atlanta, Georgia. That is Saturday, August 22nd, 2015, 12 to 9 p.m. Also, in the month of June, on June 3rd, we have the Real Rick Rosses. Atlanta's up next. Everybody remember the Real Rick Ross, right?
That's right.
We had him on the show back in March.
Yes.
My man came on and told us a little about himself. He had the entertainment company here in Atlanta, and he's looking for some artists to sign to his label. So any musicians out there, artists, come out June 3rd. Don't have the location yet, but I will keep you posted. Atlanta's up next, June 3rd. And then on June 22nd, we have the Hot Block Magazine Awards going down at the Crow's Nest on the South Side. Hot Block Magazine, I got to give it up to my man Micah Myers. This is their 8th annual award show. And your boy Ghetto Messiah has been nominated for Hottest Club Host in the ATL. Okay. So please go to hotblockmagazine.com. Find out where to vote. My box is the 8th bottom from the 8th box from the bottom. Click Ghetto Messiah, click submit.
Definitely.
And definitely, thank you for your vote. You don't have to fill out the whole survey. Click Ghetto Messiah, click submit. Thank you very much. Hotblockmagazine.com. Okay, that's it for the announcements. And now we're gonna get into the meat of why we're out here today.
That's right.
Man. Which is this killer cop culture. Mm. And all of that is spelled with K. Mm. Okay? Killer
cop
culture. KKK.
Mm. Okay. Oh, you about to give me flashbacks. Hey, go ahead.
So, in the most recent episode of the killer cop culture,
okay.
I don't even know if it's the most recent, but the biggest one in the headlines right now, because it's happening almost every day, every 28 hours.
The one they happen to catch.
Right. Los Angeles. The young lady in the backseat of the police car.
Right here in Atlanta.
So it's going on almost every day. But we're here to talk about Freddie Gray and the entire Baltimore situation.
Yes.
I'm sure everybody has heard about what's been going on the past couple of weeks. If not, I'm going to catch you up to speed. Freddie Gray was a 25-year-old young man. He was from the Gilmore Homes in Baltimore, which is one of the poorest neighborhoods in Baltimore.
That's right.
And apparently, he died from injuries sustained while in police custody.
Mm-hmm. Right.
They severed his back. Mm. Not, I didn't want to say broke his back. They severed his back, meaning in several different places, they severed his back, broke his neck, and crushed his larynx. Mm. Okay? Which sounds absolutely horrendous.
Right.
And so the 25-year-old was in the hospital in a coma for a week before he unfortunately succumbed to his injuries and passed on. So, that's what we're here to talk about today. But before we get started, I do want to say Happy Mother's Day. I did want to say that at the beginning of the show. It is Mother's Day. So, shout out to all the hardworking super moms out there. We do appreciate you. Rosetta Cheeks, I love you. You already know. Okay, Freddie Gray. Broken neck. How did it happen? Some are speculating that he was the victim of a rough ride. Apparently, a rough ride is when they place you in the paddy wagon, the back of the paddy wagon.
Right.
They don't strap you in with the seatbelt, and the driver drives erratically, jerking and throwing the vehicle while you're just rolling around.
Can I say something real quick?
Yes, sir.
Paddy wagons don't have seatbelts.
Well, whatever this vehicle is,
it's
supposed to have seatbelts, and they're supposed to be belted in when they put them in the back.
What'd they put in there with them, bricks?
I don't know, but
spine crush learning,
right?
Damn.
But they're saying Baltimore City Police are saying that his injuries happened in the inside the back of the paddy wagon.
And who was driving? Was a black man driving?
I'm not sure who was driving, because there were three officers involved, six officers involved, three black and three white.
Right.
And so
the driver is facing the worst charge.
Manslaughter.
Right. The driver, because he's supposedly the one that was.
Who was the driver? Can we get someone to look on the thing and find out who the driver was? I'm curious now.
I have the names.
They throw it out on the driver.
But there was evidence that Freddie Gray did have the imprint of a screw from the inside of the paddy wagon in his head.
Okay.
But for me, that doesn't necessarily say to me that his injuries occurred in the back of this paddy wagon.
Right.
Because if you saw the video when he was getting arrested, when they picked him up off the ground, his body was already limp.
Right.
And they literally had to drag him feet dragging on the ground to the to put him in the back of his
Vince,
paddy
wagon.
Can I
add something to that?
Yes, sir.
Shout out to Eddie Conway of Real News Network in Baltimore. You know, Black Panther, spent 40 years. The only Black Panther to spend more time in prison than Mumia Abu-Jamal.
Okay.
He personally went out and interviewed 6 different people saying, no, we saw them mangle the brother like a pretzel. And wow. That the man was screaming that he needed his asthma medication and his legs and arms were limp. This is from 6 different people, you know, and this is why I like to give a shout out to the Real News Network, you know. Right. So I know there's a conflict with Fox and CNNs and CSNBC, but yeah, Conway is there in Baltimore and they have a news organization just like the arena version of Baltimore. So
okay,
that's their story, and he's actually gotten witnesses that the media is not bringing forth.
So my thing is, with the culture, right on camera, send me my governor. So, with the culture, and get to, you know, some of the questions with the killer cop culture.
Right.
And the brutality in which this case was, this is why this is a good opportunity, we were saying earlier before the show, to have the sisters on the show. Mm-hmm. We're always getting a take from the brothers, young men uprising, black men and, you know, feel this and the war against black men. But to get from a woman's perspective, to get that feminine energy going, I would like to know, first of all, just a basic question, your take on the whole, from the murder to the response of the murder.
For me, it's a slap in the face.
Okay.
It's a slap in the face, and it's a wake-up call.
Mm-hmm.
As I mentioned to you brothers earlier, you know, I have to kind of pull back and then zoom in and come to the realization of what really just happened and how it's publicized and how easy it is for it to happen, how there's not that, it's not that big of a deal. It's almost as if you're looking at black life as just not being as valuable. And for me, I'm not a mother yet, but I, you know, we all play the role, but I'm just looking at the fact that it was just too easy for it to happen that way. As brutal as it happened that way,
right?
It's tragic. And it honestly, it angers me, it frustrates me. It makes me feel as though there should be more protection for our men, and we need to do whatever we need to do to make sure that happens.
Mm.
I feel like black men have endured a lot.
Who are we gonna get this protection from, is my question.
I can give you the nice way. I can give you the real way.
I want the real way.
The real
way.
We
on the arena.
The real way is that we get together, we form agencies, and we protect ourselves.
Like
and we
that.
Follow the law. We may not see, one of the problems that I think we have is, you know, we don't want to necessarily bend to their institution. We don't necessarily want to be a part of this arena, but if we are already in this game, so mm-hmm. we need to learn.
That's right.
It.
That's right.
Period. Mm-hmm. And y'all got the biggest ticket in your back pocket. Hello, black woman.
Exactly.
We're already in the front seat. We're already at the end of the CEO table.
Ride or die.
I have nothing to do but come home and report.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I mean?
Right.
And I feel like there should be more emphasis, which is going to go into another area where we build better relationships between black men and black women, and we gain that understanding we lost so long ago, the one that slavery took from us.
Well, let me ask a quick question, and both of you guys can answer this. Now, you mentioned about better relationships between black men and women,
mm-hmm.
and the media used a black mother slapping around her son, yeah. You know, what you doing out here,
Toya Graham.
Right, Latoya Graham. So, as a black woman, this is a sticky subject right here. I mean, when you say we gotta back our black men, so
mm-hmm.
in that scenario, when what? Give us, get you, both of y'all. Give us.
I think the most one of the most frustrating things is that the victim is always vilified.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Afterwards,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and when they keep putting that image of that mother disciplining her son, it almost vilifies him.
Right.
Like, but I do understand her as a mother, and that's her child, that's her offspring, that she wants to protect them. But like we spoke earlier, any other time, that woman probably would have been arrested or had defects at her door.
And I'm curious, because I wonder how many mothers be sending their sons off to war or join the police department. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not a problem then, but you face the same type of risk and same type of, you know, look like you're about to say something, Vince.
Well, here's my take on that situation with Toya Graham and her son, who was his name, Michael Singleton. When I first saw the situation happen, I said to myself, oh, now there's a mother who's concerned. She loves her child. Mm-hmm. Right. She's concerned that he might catch one of these bullets coming from the end of these policemen's guns in the middle of all this madness and chaos that's going on during this Baltimore riot.
Okay.
So that was my first take. So I couldn't, you know, being that it's Mother's Day today, I couldn't fault her for being a mother, being concerned for her son's safety.
Right.
Then when I analyzed it a little deeper, I got to talking to some females that didn't necessarily agree with what happened.
You didn't invite them on the arena.
And well, you know, one of them was Ebony. You know, you know our friend Ebony.
Shout out to Ebony.
But Ebony said, and I'm paraphrasing, but it'll be almost be a quote. Look at this master loving, such humiliating her son on national TV.
Right.
Hold on. Yeah, that sound like Nundy, don't it? Shout out to Nundy. Yes, go ahead, Vince. I'm sorry.
So I got to thinking about what Ebony said, and then I got to thinking about the show that we did on Willie Lynch syndrome.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that they did back during slavery was after they took the black male out of the picture through stealing him away or killing him, they made the mother the head of the household, the dominant figure. And when these little warrior slave boys would get riled up and want to, man, take this mess. She's like, no, you can't do that because master's going to either kill you or they're going to take away the crumbs that they give us.
Right.
And then so he's like, okay, mama, I won't do it because I don't want you to lose your crumbs, mama.
Right.
You know what I mean? But in essence, what it was doing is pacifying the warrior spirit in these young men that want to fight their oppressors. Mm-hmm. Right. In the essence, if you really break it down and look at it, the Baltimore riots, the Ferguson riots, it was about people who've been oppressed for so long.
Absolutely.
And the murder of Mike Brown and the murder of Freddie Gray being that tipping point to where, look,
Trayvon,
I'm sick of this mess. Trayvon, 12-year-old Tamir Rice, the name goes on. The list goes
from
on
Cleveland.
And on.
I know,
and on,
yeah,
and on.
From Cleveland. Shout out to Tamir and his mother. I think that one of the things that Dr. King so adequately put is when he said that protests or riots are the voice of the voiceless.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So you hear people who have been oppressed and don't have the ability or I don't even want to say the sad. We know what's going on with us, but according to their policies, be able to express it and have an outlet through their policies, so it's only a natural reaction. I did want to talk on the mother, because I think my problem with it is not so much even what the mother did, because it's a natural reaction.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's instinctive.
Right.
Mothers protect their young.
Right.
They love their children. And I think that was her intention, the safety of her baby.
Right.
Sure.
The problem I have with is how the enemy, powers that be will take an image and use that image for their own good.
Right.
You know, they're sending out, we see a mother going to get her baby, you know, and they'll put out there that this is the mother of the year, this is how every mother should have been.
Right.
They'll put that out to be the normal behavior of black women, to make your children complacent and not stand up for themselves.
Right.
I think that this is why I say that. And one of the reasons I love this show is that us as African people here in America have to take control of our own information outlets.
Right.
And we have to take control of our image.
Right.
You have other ethnic groups that if you even put a cartoon depicting them, you can't even say Jew and draw a picture of a Jew without the ADL.
Wait a minute.
You know it.
Not only don't just blame the Jews, blame the Muslims too. How about the Muslims down in Texas?
Well, see, they don't have the policy. they don't have the policy that the Jewish people have. Jewish people have the law. The Muslims just will take the law into their own hands. I'm not saying that that's right, you know.
Right.
So, but anyway, not to get on my point, I think that this, and end it with that. I think that that's the biggest thing would be controlling image, and that's the importance of controlling image. So, where do we go from here? Is the question. Like, what I would put out there is not just making your children complacent, but showing mm-hmm. our children
right.
how to protest, yeah. showing them how to stand up for themselves.
Right.
We can't be mad at that reaction that our youth had. Why? Because our youth are the ones being victimized.
Right, that's right. right. right.
From
right.
a certain age, they're being targeted.
Yeah. Right.
And if we don't, and it sends a message. Right.
Yeah.
This culture, this killer cop culture,
right.
as you called it, is sending a message to our young people that there's no protection. They say your mama can't protect you, your daddy, your preacher, we will get you and we will kill you.
Right.
So if anything
happens, according to Gideon, y'all can protect us.
We saying your God can't protect you?
Okay, good, all right. You can throw that out.
None of that can protect you. You know what I'm saying? None of that can protect you. They catch a Hebrew Israelite in the wrong alley at a dark
right.
night. You will find out. Y'all ain't taking none of them billy club blows for you.
Right.
You know, so it's just saying, so it sends out that image. My thing is, what can we do to be productive? What can we do to head off something like this and to give our young people an outlet for their frustration and their rage and their anger?
Do you think that The mother, she did say that she did not want her son to be another Freddie Gray.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's sad that she felt that was the only way to prevent, you know, that from possibly happening. Do you think that she, like, emasculated him? Like,
yes,
I've heard a lot of people say that.
I think that wasn't her intentions.
Right. Right.
But I think that what happens is you have a revolutionary climate. The people
right.
are ready for change. So her intentions were go get her baby. She don't care about, my mama don't care about me being, I'm a revolutionary, mama, get your ass in here, police riding mm-hmm. around this block, boy. And I'm out here, why are you questioning the brother? Brother,
right.
you all right, brother? You know, I'm all in somebody else's business.
Right.
So it's that natural motherly instinct.
Right.
But what has happened is they have taken it and they used that image. And you have a revolutionary class of people. And it did demasculate them because mm-hmm. you're doing this to them, but you're not saying there's better ways of protesting, or even not better, there's different ways
right.
of protesting. When you just tell a person not to protest,
right.
when you
right.
tell a person
right.
to suffer in silence,
right.
you're demasculating them.
And,
right.
and to your point, I think she further emasculated him when
she started.
She went on this little 15 minutes of fame world tour about,
being,
you know, why
totally
I did this
one.
And
right.
why I did
that.
I mean, it's absolutely. Enough you done slapped the man up on national television. Now he got to go and sit next to you. Why you explain to the people in the
yeah.
white world, like
yeah.
you said, talking about she need to be nominated Mother of the Year
yeah.
and best mom in the
we
world.
We need to look into
and
our finances.
Mom, and all.
Right.
I'm serious.
No, yeah, rest
but
of the
then,
talk. Yeah.
But then surprisingly, I told you, I watch Fox News.
Absolutely.
And as comical as it is, Bill O'Reilly, this is probably the only time I ever give you props, Bill O'Reilly, he said, how can we consider Toya Graham to be Mother of the Year candidate when she has 6 children by multiple fathers?
Oh, dang, he didn't just say
which,
that.
Which essentially goes to her decision-making skills. You know what I mean? And I don't know exactly how many fathers, but it is multiple fathers.
That was a low blow.
And
basically saying she a hoe.
None of the fathers. Well, that's not where I was going with it. When she went,
I got you.
Basically, none of the fathers around. And what does it say about her decision making skills and things of that nature? And so, there's a point to that though. Like, you can't say she has 6 kids from all these random people and then call her Mother of the Year. Because she did something that y'all approve of, as such as emasculating her son on national television,
right.
now you want to say it's like you said before. If she did that in the grocery store,
oh yeah, defects
because
all
he,
on that.
You know, did something. Defects would have been there. She'd be sitting in the county,
yep.
and they'd be calling her the worst woman in the world.
Yep.
Yeah.
But because it's helping in their situation and helping.
It needs
to be more black mothers out there pacifying your children because we don't want to have to deal with this mess. You know, we're sick of this. You got something to say, Tracy? Speak on it.
Speak on it, Tracy.
I'm listening, and one of the things that I do in coaching is I'm always looking for the silver lining in the root.
Okay.
Because there's nothing you can put all kind of icing on a cake, but if it's nasty cake, it's nasty cake.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I keep coming back to in the midst of all of this is the symbiotic relationship between black man, black woman, and then also the emotional well-being of our people.
Okay.
Because that once we can get that intact, we'll understand that even with all the discipline we try to throw, there's a difference between reacting and responding.
Right.
And that makes the difference in how we are perceived and even on how we get evolved past all this craziness.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because they already have it in their heads that we're going to respond. And what she What she did was she reacted.
Okay. Right.
She didn't stop and think consciously of what she was doing and what was going on. And I get that we have fight or flight, but fight or flight was made for the jungle when the lion running after you. That wasn't a lion situation.
Right.
There were lots of other young people around. There were cameras, and I'm sure other parents looking for their children. So at some point, I'm just waiting to hear everybody to just say, I'm going to be responsible for my part in getting this done, starting with, because we talked about the woman not making wise decisions in men. Let's talk about the daddy. What was he?
Right.
Let's talk about any man that's older than him could have walked up and assumed position of father and said, hey, bro, what are you doing?
They probably were throwing rocks.
I'm like,
they
don't
probably see.
At what point do we address that? Because if somebody put their hand in the stove, what do we say? You knew it was hot. What point do we say, okay, I'm not going to put my hand in the stove anymore, and if I do, I'm going to be very well protected and make sure it's off. And I just feel like there needs to be more emphasis placed on that.
I think that that's the whole point. I think that there has been a campaign, the fatherhood campaign, to say, where are the black men?
Right.
We need to step up. But I think that that's the whole evolution of the black man here in America, trying to redefine that. Because we have to redefine that role. We still have the roles of the 50s and the 60s for the black man. When now the black woman may be making more, you know, the whole dynamic has changed. He may be.
Yeah, but even with the manhood thing, you know, you got brothers who agree with the Malcolm method, like you and I as black nationalists. Then you got people that agree with the Martin method. You know what I'm saying?
I think as men,
there's two different schools of thoughts here. Yeah, you know, and then you got the spiritual people.
Yeah.
You know, and then you got the people that just want to bang. Put in some. I know, not you, Yang. I'm just. Throwing little shots here. But what I'm saying is that black people as a whole, and you got black women that fall along with it, because you got the Nundies and you got the Ebonies, you know what I'm saying? And then you got some more, like the sister that slapped her son around. Yeah. So you got schools of thoughts, like she just mentioned about the father putting him aside. I would have been throwing rocks with him, but I would have been more organized. I would have like, yo,
well,
brothers,
I think that goes, that goes would have been into the question, and I'm gonna go right to you, because I think that goes into the question of who propagates the hardest. That we have to create a revolutionary culture. Mm-hmm. It's not about what position these fathers are in. We have the youth. It's about who's gonna reach the youth first.
Okay,
you know what I'm saying? So we have to propagate a revolutionary culture. We have to redefine black manhood. I can't teach. The times have changed economically, socially, politically.
Right.
So I can't tell my son, this is what a black man does. This is what, you know, black. He's going to have to defy that. Now, this is what a responsible man does.
Right.
This is what, you know, a successful to go into, say, he's disciplined, he plans, he organized. But to defy, I can't say, well, the black man is the predominant breadwinner anymore.
Right.
I can't say that's, you have to defy your relationship with your queen, in society, how it contributes and edifies the black community and builds us, is going to be a question that this generation come up has to decide. Back in our parents' times and our great parents' times, they didn't deal with the phenomena called baby mama. That's a whole new phenomena to the black community.
Right. Started in the
90s. You know what I'm saying? If they did have baby mamas, they had whole other families across town. You dig? They took care of business. That's your brother. Damn, he's 21 and I'm 20. You know, and I knew dad, so they had families. We're dealing with a whole new culture. Phenomenal cultural shift. So we're dealing with baby moms, so they have to defy that. The diseases that go around sexually, just everything, the whole society has changed. So it's going to be up to the next generation to defy what black manhood is, what black womanhood is, the parameters and the diameters of black relationships.
And how to respond.
Scientifically, with our guidance. Not us telling them what to do, but doing what elders do in the African community and offering guidance and advice from the experiences of their life.
Mm-hmm. And I want to piggyback off that, because that's where I was going to go actually with guidance. Because
you can cow back.
I'm a cow back off my brother, you know.
That's right.
Because like I said on Gideon's show earlier, your youth are angry.
Mm-hmm. Right.
They're very angry.
I'm angry.
They feel disenfranchised. Yeah. But our youth, clearly, we're older and more intellectual, and we can we're in control of our emotions and our thoughts. The younger generation, they need guidance. They're angry. A lot of them don't know why they're angry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but how can you guide a people who are who won't respond at all? I think it's more frustration out of that. Like my son's like, you know, when which one of the black males this year got shot down? I don't know. It was
Anthony Hill, Mike Brown.
Name one, I don't name.
Nicholas Thomas.
Yeah. So my son's like, you know, am I going to get shot? I was like, dang.
Wow. How old is your son?
Oh, my son's 17.
Wow.
And so when he asked me that, I was like, I didn't know how to react to that. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, there are, like you said, balances of what I can't mention on TV, of course, you know. But, you know, like I said, the only thing that I object, I want to give a shout out to Unc and King Noble, you know, because they weighed in on the conversation. And they both were saying that they were for the rioting. I'm for it. I just want it to be more organized, but I'm not against it.
I'm not for the rioting. I don't.
Right, we're the same age, right?
I don't condone the violence in the fire setting. They burnt down an elderly home and all that. Mm. But I don't condone that type of violence. But I also can't sit here and condemn their anger, because they have a right to be angry. But like you said, it needs to be more organized and more, I guess, straightforward and in a direction that's going to actually bring about change. Because without this rioting, white people doing sitting at home going, look at these animals acting like animals. Why are they turning and burning up their own stuff? And it's not going to bring about change.
It
doesn't bring about change, but it doesn't. I'm not condoning, I'm condemning it, so that's on tape. You know, but I will say this, scientifically analyzing the situation, it brought attention, because I do believe, in my personal opinion, had Baltimore not erupted, those police officers would have never been charged.
Correct.
There you go. There
correct.
You go.
Now that's right. That's a true fact.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
For when people say that nothing comes from rioting, or I'm gonna say use rioting as opposed to saying protesting, I think of like the Boston Tea Party. Mm. I think about no one is calling
American
these
history.
Police officers thugs.
Right.
and not only that, like I mean, America was built off of
terrorism.
Looting.
And
invading.
Right.
Still is.
Right. It's not a crime if you win. You know, only the losers get persecuted.
That's
right.
Go ahead.
Which is why we're still being persecuted.
Exactly.
Do you think?
Okay, I've noticed also with like people that are like more affiliated with religions, they were more opposed to the rioting as opposed to
depends
people.
What religion.
Right.
The Christians and Hebrews. Not the Muslim brothers, because y'all put in work.
But they almost make it seem like, I mean, as opposed to rioting or protesting, like it would be better to just be at home
roll
praying.
Over.
Wait on the Lord.
Well, no, like, that's not. My, one of the solutions, because I helped host Rick Ross's Up on Game Forum, which is a community forum last week.
Damn, you just a busy little
bee. Yes, it is. Clapped in the arena, God.
But on that forum, we talked about police brutality and we were talking about solutions. My first solution, being a former teacher, is education. We have to provide proper education channels for these kids to truly learn. Because in the school system I taught in, the kids weren't learning because the teachers weren't teaching.
Right.
The teachers were doing what they wanted to do. They were changing answers on tests. They were doing whatever to get money, and they weren't teaching, which is why I want to build my own school. Like you said, we got to have our own.
We got to have our own.
I want to build my own school because when I was in that so-called system, I said to myself, I can do it better.
Let me get this straight. You want to separate from this American system here?
I didn't say the American system. I'm talking about the education system.
Let me get you straight. You about to mess up our profit, our prison, our school.
That's the prison. I'm glad you brought that up.
Right.
We need to talk about that.
You ain't going to mess up our profit.
One of the things, though, I wanted to jump in here and say is that going to Cleveland gave me a whole new, man, I didn't pat this brother on the back, gave me a whole new respect for our school teachers. Because I was, you know, I was hard. Oh, they, you know, school teachers, this. My father, Chairman Cahar, worked at a, shout out to Berea's Children,
Black Power,
whatever, and things he was working at. Yeah. And he went into school. He was a counselor in the school.
Right.
And he said it's the conditions that these teachers, you know, have to teach under. And he said he was a troubled counselor, where he seen the troubled kids.
The troubled kids.
He said when he would go home, when he seen the environment these children were coming from, he told the teachers and the principal, we were lucky to get them. You're lucky that this dude is, we get him 6-7 hours a day to sit still hungry.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Or if he does come to school, one of the reasons they diagnose our children with attention deficit disorder is because before he came to school, he didn't have a Pop-Tart, a Juicy Juice box, a yummy snacks, a cookie powder. He full of sugar.
Right.
He can't sit down. He hadn't had it. He had sugar pop cereal with chocolate milk. Right. He's full of sugar.
Yes.
So he can't sit down. And I'm hold that thought 1 second. Just to say that, though, so to add to that, not just education. And this is why I send shouts out to the Third Development Panther Party, or what they call the original Panther Party under Bobby and Huey P., was that they understood, and shouts out to Nundy, who has constantly been screaming this out.
Yeah.
They understood the importance of developing a social program, a breakfast for the children could get to school.
Right.
So you can, you know, get your mind on
the
educational system.
You know what I mean? That's all part of a good education system. Go ahead,
Tracy. And I just wanted, again, to put emphasis on the responsibility that we hold. You said something that was absolutely key. It is scientifically proven that our environment will shape our thought processes and it shapes our DNA. And I think that we all hold a personal responsibility for our households.
Yeah.
And that goes back to relationships.
Yeah.
And that goes, that piggybacks into communication and how we fight or fight. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, we can complicate it and get real political and talk about what the system is doing, this, that, and the other. But as soon as we get home, we have all the power in the world.
Well, wait a minute, hold up. I gotta throw a curveball. This is for Gideon.
I'm ready.
You got the mayor, who's a sister.
Okay.
And he got the prosecutor, who's a sister.
And the police chief.
And the police chief.
I'm talking about taking personal accountability for your home.
Right, right. But I understand the home part.
Okay.
But we're looking at a system here.
Right. Okay.
A systematic system that people are is starting to unfold. And so, you know, shout out to Gideon. He'll say, well, you know, the black women, they make up the biggest part of the voting, and voting don't work. So let me ask, since we want to be, let's talk about that. Let's talk about the voting. Let's talk about the black women being the biggest voting block pool. And what can we do as sisters to?
Before we get her out of the house with her keys to get in the car, she's at home being a mother.
Right.
And him, before he's out, maybe trying to help his children get off the street, maybe trying to not throw rocks, whatever, they're at home. They all taking baths, they all eating. And at that point, there's an opportunity for them to connect. Go ahead.
Well, Tracy, connect on.
We're going to make McGavin, you here.
Go ahead. I'm fine with that because I'm firm on that. Because I recognize, because when I look at the difference between the upbringing of someone who had that connection and then those of us who struggle for it, because our people didn't know no better.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, we have, it's a perpetual cycle. And what, we just got to stop now.
We got to, and do it.
We just got to do it now. We just got to do it. Well,
what is, my thing is, what do we connect on? Because I agree with you. Man, I wholeheartedly agree. I think that it starts at home.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it's a lack of culture. And we got into this thing about multiculturalism. It's a lack of, to me, the African culture. Because what do we connect on? Can I connect with a black woman who, the... What defied black manhood stopped going from daddy's home, daddy does this, you know, black manhood, even if I worked on a trash truck. Black manhood is now defied in this age of materialism by what you possess.
That's right.
Nigga got rims, dog, you know what I'm saying? Right. So it's what we possess. And so,
I must live in a different reality.
Yeah, well, you do. I mean, not everybody. You know, us on the panel. This is why we get, but just a lot of people that we work with.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You know, Jesus said, going to you atheists, I know y'all don't get into it, but Jesus said, I hope I'm quoting it right, Brother Gideon. When they asked him why he was sitting with the sinners and the publicans, he said, is a doctor not sent to the sick? So us that are informed, you know, it's one of my jobs to go and enlighten those who don't know, not to look down on them, but to try to enlighten them.
Right.
And one of the things I see when dealing with them is their moral compass is measured to another people's culture.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's brother, you know, you home right now, you looking for a job or whatever. But in the meantime, in between time, you might need to sweep. You might need to take a cooking lesson or two, bro.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You might need to help out and shift that down. Not
or you might need to pick.
And men don't do dishes or this and that. And the sister coming home and you don't have this or that X, Y, and Z. So our moral compass and what we measure our standards by, I think, have to really go through a cultural revolutionary mm-hmm. shift.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I want to go back to what
thank you.
Black Sun said thank about you. Voting.
Yes.
Thank voting you. Is...
I want to get her take, too.
Okay, we just want to get... But voting, I'm...
Because Tracy just like... Just kind of danced around and did the Matrix. Right. She did the Matrix, bro. So go ahead.
Now we're trying to eat it.
That's problematic, though. You know, okay. It's funny cool. because the homosexuals, they get involved and they get things happening. The Hispanics get things happening. We the only people who say, the system don't work.
Well, voting is important, but there's something more important than voting. Because voting...
Well, it's
the bigger picture, right.
Bigger picture,
but voting gives you an avenue for your voice to be heard. But you need something more than your voice being heard to make change in this country. So you got to take politics a step further and get into the realm of lobbying. And what do you got to do to be a lobbyist? What do you have to do to be a lobbyist? You got to have money.
Right.
You got to have money.
Right.
Money
right.
is the only thing that's going to get laws changed in this country.
Are we not the biggest consumers?
We got the money.
Are we not the biggest consumers in the United States of America, in the world?
In the world.
We got the money. But like Tracy said earlier, we need to start our own organization. Yanga said we need to start our own organization. Pool our resources and our money together. Go to Capitol Hill and lobby like all these other companies, pharmaceuticals, and all this other stuff do to get these laws changed.
But one of the things they do when they take our biggest and our brightest out of the universities and these Fortune 500 companies, the people that could enact these laws and help us to organize to get lobbyists, they take them and they sell the hell out.
Right.
Okay, but Tracy, let me say something.
Sure.
You could take care of the home, be the best wife. They chased the man and broke his spine because he looked at him.
The eyeball. Yeah.
Now, they said that it is not illegal to look a man in his eye. Mm-hmm. It is not illegal to run. So that involves political involvement.
Right.
If you can have the best household in the world, if they come with laws and legislations and policies saying, you know what, we're going to outlaw filling the police.
Okay.
So at what point in time do the black man and the black woman, do we come together and start being a voting bloc like the homosexuals, like the Hispanics, like the Jews, like everybody else is getting things So, can you touch on that?
I
really feel you, but at the same time, just like, who exactly are we going to vote for? Donald Trump.
No.
Okay,
we're
going to
vote for policy. Gay marriage is not a person.
Policy.
The Dream Act is not a person. Mm-hmm. Let me say this again.
Who's going to
gay marriage
these policies?
The gays put together the Equal Marriage Act. The Hispanics put together the Dream Act. In fact, we had, shout out to LaCecio. Let me educate everybody. The Hispanics, the illegal aliens, go to college for free. Let me say this again in my matrix voice. The Hispanics go to college for free. And they're not even legal. But you know why? Because they are a voting bloc. The Republican Party almost tore apart because the homosexuals came together and said, you know what, you're going to stop ganking us for our money. I want to be able to goddamn give my lover here dental, medical. So it was an economical issue. We're the only ones talking about, oh, God didn't make Adam and Eve, Adam and Steve. And the Bible says, and the Quran says, we're the only ones stuck in that.
Yeah.
It was a political, economical fight. Because the homosexual was tired of the capitalists getting in their pockets. Get your hands out of my pocket.
Yeah.
Quote Malcolm X. So again, I hear the happy home thing and you know, put food on the table and take, you know, kiss your husband. I'm talking about, when do we get involved in the policies that affect our children? Because you know, if your son hang around with other kids, they have a legislation saying that's a gang.
Right.
That is a gang. You find a group of black people who are motivated to do something when they already don't feel loved.
Okay.
At some point, there's got to be a source of motivation, because all these other groups that you were talking about, they have stable homes. They have a source. And it ain't got to be a Jesus. But it's family, it's home. So I feel like at some point, and it doesn't take that much work. All it takes is for us to do what we're doing here. I love you. We good. Now let's go. Do you see what I mean? Right. But we got to start somewhere. I didn't say stay there forever and stay in the house lovey-dovey. I said we need to start somewhere.
Okay, but as a black woman, you know you got to get involved in politics at some point in time.
Oh, that's that, absolutely fine.
Take your sister's hand and say, sister, we got to get involved in politics.
And that's fine.
Okay.
And that's fine. I'm not opposed to that.
I can't stand politics. But I know that's a reality.
But politics can stand you.
In order to get right. In order
get
to
in here, Yanga.
We've been trying to skip the politics for a minute now.
Get in here, man.
We just got to find a starting place. That's my point. We have got to start. Because if it worked, what we were doing already thus far, we'd be there.
Okay, so can we all agree that police brutality is wrong?
Absolutely.
Severing a man's spine is
absolutely
wrong.
Absolutely, it is.
So can we, I don't know, maybe talk to the mayor, who's a black woman. In fact, the new Department of Minister of Defense is a sister, right?
Yeah. So, oh, Loretta Lynch?
Yeah.
Loretta Lynch, right.
I think a bigger problem is like the policing in black neighborhoods, though,
yes.
Or like.
Yeah. Lynn had a solution for that.
The legislation for like crack cocaine and versus cocaine is like a bigger problem.
But we don't, it's like what the brother is actually saying is our lack of involvement.
Right.
One of the things that we don't do, we look at politics as being something separate from our day-to-day existence. Like Yanga said.
I know I did for
you know,
a long time.
Like our son said, you know, you may not get involved with politics, but politics get involved
with
right.
You.
And your children.
It affects you every day.
You pay food taxes, light bills, gas prices, everything. If you work and they taking money out of your check, we know that this country was founded on that very thing. No taxation without representation. You know what I'm saying? And when you look at out of 400, I forget how many elected positions there are, 400 something thousand, we got 80,000 home beings. So we're being taxed unproportionately to have our representation within these elected offices. We don't believe that voting is the complete change.
No.
We're not reformists, but we believe that radical reform, that radical participation in the political system can lead to revolution.
It's the start, like she was asking, right?
But not participating in the political system is counter-revolutionary.
Oh, yeah. Most definitely.
Because you're not doing
that's a mouthful right there.
A lot of people
just
feel like it doesn't do anything.
Exactly. And that's
counter-revolutionary.
Can I address that, please?
Please, go ahead.
Let me give you an example. Brother Cell, Sundown. You know, this is why I say black people don't know how to vote. You know, the homosexuals and the Hispanics, they know how to vote.
Mm-hmm.
You voted before?
I have.
Okay, you went in there and voted for Obama, right?
That's it.
How many black people knew you were gonna vote and y'all made that agreement y'all were gonna vote?
And we kind of discussed it, but.
You kind of discussed it?
Right. You know, we kind of discussed it.
Right, well, the Hispanics.
The reasons why we voted
right.
were not discussed as much.
Oh,
you said Hispanics going, they marry everybody. This is who you vote for.
This is who you vote for.
Right.
And the LGBT, you're going to vote for so-and-so, so-and-so. Yeah. We're going to get that legislation. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. They get it done because they know how to vote. If you're not voting in a block, you do not know how to vote.
That's what gets me about black people. Now I have to say that about us because I got attackers every now and then. We do that, man. We really are narcissist people, man. We have narcissism. We go, we say, voting don't work. How you know? I voted. But I didn't get who I wanted. I voted. You voted, and who you voted for didn't win, so voting don't work. You know, so we have to be realistic in our goals, and that goes back to saying what we say that other ethnicities, they make political issues a part of their everyday life. The Dream Act affects them. So it's a part of their everyday life. So they're going to educate their children on everything that this is what the people are trying to do to us. This is what this country is saying.
Right.
So we have to get out of that that apathy.
That's right.
Where
right.
we sit and we allow people to dictate the policy. The only thing you do, I love what you said. You can react and you can respond.
That's right.
And the only thing that we do is end up reacting.
Right.
Because we've allowed other people to make these policies to create a climate where police can murder us with impunity.
In fact, you had a real solution, Yanga. Yanga said if you start insuring $10 million on every black person, them damn insurance people black, don't kill them, don't
bro, I said that on the bridge.
You did too, right?
I was up on game for them. I made sure I shot you out.
Was that a good solution?
That was a great solution.
Because that's what capitalists understand.
Yeah, hit that money.
I have a concern there now. Let's go back to my notion of home.
Okay.
We've got classes for everything. You're an educator.
Yes, ma'am.
And so you're aware of what we're educated on.
Yes.
To a most part.
Right.
who's going to teach our youngsters right before they're at the age to vote on how important voting is, the political arena?
That's a community.
Okay, so before
Vince can break down the whole voting, we did a thing where teachers were sent 20 years to prison on some dang
thing.
Okay, I'm clear.
Right. I don't expect it to come from the system, obviously.
Right, right, right. So
I expect, like, when I have children,
okay,
I'm going to be the one that's going to start at home.
Yes.
Do you see what I mean?
Yes,
right.
Like, but, yes. We put a lot of weight on school teachers, and God bless the school teacher, because they're main 20 mm-hmm. in the class. I mean, 30, yeah. It's work.
Yeah,
all these personality types, but we cannot just strictly rely on them to give our children what they need. And at home, if you can't get along with your son because you're putting your husband down and he ain't got no respect mm-hmm. for his daddy,
right. mm-hmm.
he's not going to hear what you're talking about, especially yeah, right. politically, because that definitely don't apply to him.
Exactly.
Because right. nothing in a suit with a tie can tell him what to do at that point.
Exactly.
However, those suit and ties will make policies and legislation.
But at some point, we've got to make it possible. At some point, we got to put our egos down and say, look, this is what it's going to take.
Exactly.
At home, I've got to be the one to teach, so I need to. Since all my child is going to see for the time being, realistically, are men in suits running the country, then I need to, one, show main respect to that in the house.
Well, as a black nationalist, I want my children to be part of that, to be maybe.
That's the key. Okay. To me, that's the key. I think that's what happens. It's not just showing them men in a suit, showing them this, it's right. making
right.
our policymakers.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? When I deal with my sons, I'm dealing with the next, I'm building his government.
Right.
Yes. See, my government's jacked up.
Right.
I'm not trying to teach you how to be included in this government.
Yeah. Right.
I'm teaching you how to be a changer right. of what you see your dad going through. Man, right. you see me struggling, man. You got to help your boy, help your dad.
That's right.
You know, yeah. I need you to be able to change the system.
That's right.
I need you so you got to know. Right. So you got to, and like you said, it goes. That's why I'm agreeing with what you said.
Right.
It starts at home. You know, if you want to teach a system of compassion, he has to see compassion at home. The first social actions and the interactions. Before a politician gets up there and becomes a diplomat, before he knows how to deal with other countries, he has to see how his mother and father related and how to handle things diplomatically. But I think that what we have to, in my opinion, of course, I'm going to say what we have to do.
Right.
One of my opinions would be that we don't even use the word politics. Let's throw that word out there. Let's teach them that this is a part of life.
That's right.
Yes.
That you need to be the captain of your own ship, the master of your own fate.
That's
that
right.
you control your destiny and don't rely on anyone to make decisions. Like we tell them, well, if Boo Boo jumped off the bridge,
you're gonna jump off the bridge.
And when if he come back and say, well, you don't vote, so they telling you jump off the damn bridge and you
jump.
Because
right.
you're not even offering a fight, Dad. You don't get involved.
And can I add to that?
Yeah, please.
And if you don't believe in voting, stop discouraging others.
Yeah.
Stop
yeah.
it.
That's,
yeah. Stop
that,
it.
That
well, my boy,
stop
right, it. My boy said he voted for Yahshua.
And I'm not necessarily talking about Gideon. I'm talking about anybody.
Anybody.
King Noble.
Right.
Unk.
No, they're right. not going to vote, but they want monarchies.
Oh, that's right. They want kingdoms. Monarchies.
They don't want no
right.
democracy.
Right.
They
right.
have
kingdoms. And Uncle Maya, out. Yo.
No, I'm just going to. So do you think voting and legislation, it would override, like, protesting and riots?
I think no. I hope it doesn't. I hope it doesn't. I'm in one brief. I hope that it doesn't. But let's go ahead.
Can I answer that question? There's a state called Alabama, and we have 10 commandments. And I'd be damn. We ain't gonna let no homos. But guess what? The homosexuals like we gonna pass this.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And slowly but surely they got surrounded, and it was only one county left. And they were like, yo, you know, we got to give in.
My thing is, I think it's a strategy. I think that there's a difference between, see, we call it in the Baltimore the uprising. They're calling right. it a riot. Here's the difference, though. When you go through a channel and you're showing the contradictions, I think when you have policies, like we got to go through all this for them to see that that's a criminal act.
That's right. right.
Clearly it's a criminal act.
Yeah. Right.
Clearly. But when you have policies, when you have a above ground, when you have people that have participated in the political process, that they have put their and things like that happen, then they can't say it's right, it's an uprising. And that gets world attention.
Right.
Just like the people in other countries say, we don't think that this country will give us a fair election, send the UN ambassadors. Send the UN in to That's come right. and count the damn votes. Mm-hmm. The same way they found all those black votes in the closet in Florida.
Uh-huh.
Why we didn't demand for the international courts to come
That's
in
right.
and monitor the whole democratic process.
Right.
Because there was a crime that had been committed. Negroes got amnesia. We forget. They flashed the new. We got that new Big Mac coming out. Drake got that new song coming out. We got about a crime that's been committed.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You want to forget about just like what they're going to do now. They're going to kill somebody else. We happy that they locked the police officers up. Yeah, they locked them up. They haven't been indicted.
They haven't indicted them. They haven't.
And they're going to kill somebody else, and we're going to turn our eyes from this. What happened to the white man that shot that brother in the back 8 times? Yeah. Somebody tell me what happened to that. Has he been indicted? We don't know, because we're talking about what's happening in Baltimore.
Right.
They let that white boy out the back door.
Yeah, I'm sure they did. But and to your point about, you know, it happened to Freddie Gray, and then it happened to the dude, Walter Scott in North Carolina. It's basically the same movie. Replaying over and over again with different characters.
Players, yeah.
With different characters. You have a different cop behind the gun.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You have a different victim laying on the ground.
Okay,
you have
Vince,
different families
can that
are violated. What's up?
When an officer gets suspended with pay, that's a policy.
That is a policy.
Right.
Right. It goes back to lobbying. I mean, to me, that has to be one of the ultimate solutions. But then that's
not ultimate, because people take that and run with it, like Gideon. It's part of the bigger
It's one of the bigger chunks that we have to deal with because white people don't understand anything but money.
But exactly. And I want to throw this, and money. This is going to be for the next show, because I know Sister's going to be mad. You're looking in Baltimore. You're looking at those three powerful black women.
Yeah.
My question is, how do they perceive black men? Are they those sisters? Nigga, I ain't care.
Right.
So do they perceive them like that? Because a lot of times, those can be the instances and cases how the black man is perceived. This is why I have a problem with these and our children being in school so long, with white women raising our children. Does she see a doctor? Does she see a lawyer? Does she see a
Black children are disproportionately suspended from school.
Exactly.
And black children are disproportionately cut from the higher academic classes,
absolutely,
the honor classes. And black children are disproportionately put on these ADD medications.
Yeah. That's right.
And
mom was just getting your baby off the Pop-Tarts.
Imbalance. Yeah. You're creating, they're telling you the child has a chemical imbalance, but this ADD medication is giving them chemical imbalance.
You're about to start a whole other show.
That's
we
what I'm
deal
saying.
With black women and nutrition.
Nutrition.
That's what you're about to start more, bro.
But we live in food deserts. We don't have fresh fruits that come to our thing. You and I were talking about it in the store.
We went to the
grocery store.
We got 5 minutes. We got people.
Okay. All right.
I want to give everybody a minute to offer a solution to what we can do about Freddie Gray and this mass rampant police brutality. Ava, start with you.
Okay. The biggest thing is, I would say, classism and racism is something that affects
everybody.
And just the policing. A lot of people were saying that they were destroying their own neighborhood, but they don't own the CVS. They don't own these stores.
The liquor store that got burned down.
Right on.
And stop calling us thugs.
Please.
What's up?
CNN.
Tracy.
I'm an idealist, so I wish I could give everybody the perception of the black man that I have.
Right.
Because if it was up to me, we'd all just take a pause in time, breathe, give every black man a break, you know, and then let them recruit, because there's, without a doubt, that there's the power already is in there. Like, black men are already just that powerful. You know what I'm saying? So I empathize and I sympathize, but I see so much power and so much energy. I'm just like, what are we waiting on? Let's just you know what I mean? And then I just hope to, if I find a young girl as I'm mentoring, I just plan to instill the same thing. Let them see the truth.
Here's one of my ultimate solutions. Since I feel like we've been victims of a discreet government-sponsored genocide since they brought us over here.
Yeah,
I agree with Brother Malcolm X. I agree with Dr. Makungu Akinyele, National Organizer for the Malcolm X Grassroots Movement, who said we need to go to the United Nations and say genocide is being committed against us, and we need to go in numbers, and we need to let our voice be heard on a massive scale.
Damn.
My last words is just basically this, man. In the last thing, you control your destiny.
Correct.
Yes.
You are the master of your own fate. Just take control of your life.
Yes.
You know what has to be done to do what has to be done.
And I like to say is, watch, son, keep doing them rides, because like she said, they don't own nothing, but I own it. So if I take out insurance, I get $1 million policy. So yeah, keep burning down them buildings and how you pay black policy. So I can either blame it on y'all, because if I just sit behind my own business, then it's
kind of get paid, right?
Yeah, can't get paid.
If I had a business, and I know them Koreans did that, when they seen the police and killed another nigga, I'd have went and raised my insurance policy.
That's right.
That's terrible.
You know, it's going to go to. I mean, but that's the real thing. I would love to have another show too.
Yeah.
Where we discuss black relationships because I think that's
very important. Yeah.
I would love if you guys were to have a show on ADHD because I myself was clinically diagnosed early with ADHD.
Ooh.
And I just refused to take the medicine. But I will tell you this, what I know for sure. They wanted to remove my ability to create.
Yeah.
To think.
And that's all it is.
Right.
They said the same thing, and I was cured when my mama came up to the school.
Right.
Let me throw this, because I wanted to make sure I got this point in here. Black churches. We need to put more responsibility on these black churches to do things in our communities. The black churches have pulled in $420 billion since the early 1980s. And what are they doing with it?
Where's the money?
What do we have to say
that is ours? They're going to take that tax exempt stuff.
What are they doing? Right. They got the tax exempt stuff. But what are they ultimately doing for the community? Because we ain't seen it. We ain't got no schools.
Right.
All right. Next week, Ahmed, I'm trying to hold out for you, man. We're going to deal with those flying guillotines in Yemen. Flying guillotines. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
They got them.
Flying guillotines.
Yes, flying guillotines. They have barrels with blades in them, and it blows up, and then in the span of a football field, killing people. So,
All right.
And Saudi Arabia and America backs that. So we're going to deal with that next week. We out.
Keep it going.
Why
you tell me the team was
you didn't know about the flying guillotines?
No, I didn't hear about it.
Yeah, they got
it does
barrels.
Surprise me the level of barbarity.
Every country has outlawed it except for Saudi Arabia and America. And guess who manufactures those weapons?
Who? Us.
Yeah, it's a barrel, like I said, and they're blades.
Yeah.
And when the bomb shoots, the blades, each span shoots out in the football field, and the blades just cutting everything in sight.
Cutting everything in sight.
Man, it's sadistic, man.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
This is the...
But that's... Yeah, those are terror tactics.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying? It's overkill.
All right, we got peace.
Peace.
Record.
Oh, yeah. Black sun in the hizzle. Oh, for shizzle dizzle. We got an excellent show here today. But first, I want to say the views and opinion and that of the arena does not reflect that of Black Sun, its staff, its affiliates, or associates. And the views of Black Sun, let me say it again, the views of Black Sun does not reflect that of the arena. We are a council, okay? All right. This week, we're gonna do Mr. Gray some justice.